My name is Dora Vasileva. I am a salon owner in central London. What makes my salon unique and profitable? I only work with organic products. My passion is to create a world where people avoid toxic products. Why pure rest pillow? They are chemically free pillows and they provide in-flight comfort and luxury. I would like to share two stories, one in about well-being and another about air travel luxury. Well-being, I will read some article. Do you know what is in bed with you? The main toxic chemical in polyester, most pillows are, is ethylene glycol, which gets absorbed by our bodies via inhalation and throughout our skin. It can damage kidneys and the central nervous system. Decidedly, not the best thing for your beauty sleep. The second story is I listen to my clients complain about business class and first class flights. Here's what they say. The pillows are uncomfortable, smelly, and irritating. So, pure rest pillow. They are hypoallergenic, clean, crisp, and filled with lavender, and reduce the fine lines and wrinkles. I hope I showed you a little how a little change can make a big difference. And let's say hello to in-flight comfort and luxury. Any questions?
Thank you. Thank you, Dora. And thank you for kicking off this session. So can we touch a few of your products?
Exactly.
We're asking you a few questions.
Get off the pillow.
Obviously, I think I get the idea of the product. Have you sort of sized the market yet? Do you know how big the market is that you're going after for this luxury pillow product?
Yes, the airlines and airport gift shops. Some of the people, since I started, they're already interested of this. So the pitching when it was with the voting. So I hope it's a...
The airlines and the gift shops is the outlet.
The airports,
do you have some idea of the size of that market in terms of volume or value in any way?
Probably it's millions.
Millions, okay. Thank you.
People who complain about business class and first class should be shot. Really, get back there in premium economy and economy and get a grip. It smells absolutely fantastic. I mean, you could see something like that at home, absolutely.
Yeah, that's with lavender.
Oh.
Which every time when you squeeze it and just shrink and start smell again.
Okay. And what kind of margin do you have between so what you're buying this in for and what you can sell it for? Does that give you enough to be able to sell it into airlines?
Yes. Yes, so especially for the airlines, they got a special size pillows which they wanted.
Okay.
We will provide for them. And for example, for the gift shops, that could be a different size, any size we can.
So how much would a pillow like this sell for?
So for just sell.
Yes.
For one unit, it's going to be $10.50. For if it's about 1,000, it's going to be $9.
Yeah. And what about, so 5,000 is going to be selling it to a shop. Or to an airline?
Yes, to airlines,
And how much, if I was to buy that as a customer in a shop, how much would I be paying for it?
So, it could be around 12, 13 pounds, because still is on projection. We haven't started yet.
Yes.
But
and I think
we are ready.
Just be really careful about your pricing, that you allow yourself
exactly.
enough to...
Exactly, but just to make it, the cost is about £5.75.
Oh, okay. Okie dokie.
Okay, and in your business plan that you've got currently, how many are you forecasting to sell in your first, give me just kind of first year, second year?
So for the first year, we wanted about 2 million of the pillows, yeah.
So that's 2 million pillows?
Yes.
Okay.
2 million pillows?
So £20 million in revenue in your first year?
Yes. So it could be more. That is just for startup.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
Dora, have you actually had an opportunity to talk to any customers about the product yet?
Yes.
And what have they said? What's their response?
They like it. They asked me to buy it because we haven't started yet. It's just that it's just
And these
a sample.
Are the airlines or consumers?
Consumers and the airlines also. We spoke with the airlines.
Okay.
So if you were to secure orders from the key airlines, because that's where you'd probably get that sort of volume, 2 million, how have you got operational production?
Yes, we've got manufacturing in Bulgaria, which is ready to start.
Okay, very good. And how many people's in your team currently? If you talk to me about how many people you've got in the business at the moment.
In the business, I've got, just for my team, like managers, we are 3 people.
Can I ask where the investment money would be spent?
On materials and cost of the manufacture and transport.
Mm-hmm. Besides the kind of the lavender scenting, is there anything else that kind of sets this apart from kind of other pillows that are currently on the market?
So for now we just plant the pillows, but in time we can do something else also.
Okay, have you had a thought about that, what that other thing might be?
Yeah, we did, but not yet. We haven't decided yet.
So your the competition to this, I mean, obviously I've looked in retail stores in airports and I agree with you that a lot of airlines pillows are pretty rubbish, but there's obviously a range of quality there already. Is there anything edging into this high quality end of the travel pillow market? I mean,
so for now they don't have any other, so they've got on the retails for bedding but not for the airlines.
Okay. You're in a pretty unique place at this stage.
Yeah.
Good.
In terms of your product development, I think, you know, looking at the pillow, and I love the smell, I love the feel of it. I think that you've done a great job there in terms of preparing the product. I think, you know, it'd be interesting to see how you could either make it unique and very difficult to copy, because that's one of the things that's...
Yeah, we will patent it. Not yet, because we haven't started, but we will do the patent, of course.
Okay. And have you got a brand name as well that would go with
yes,
it?
Yes, we will
Great.
Do that.
That would be very helpful.
Yeah.
Good. Well, Dora, we're just about out of time, so thank you for
thank
being
you
the first
much.
One of this session. Well pitched and well answered on the questions, so, and we wish you every success.
Thank you very much.
Well done,
yeah, thank you.
When it comes to buying, we have millions of options, either online or in a store. In comparison, there are just a handful of places to sell the things that we own, and the process is not so easy. Take this item, for instance. To sell it, I'd have to create a listing, take pictures, write a description, choose a price, and hope that it sells. Most people either don't have the time or know how to follow this process. As a result, we lose value for the things that we own and don't get rid of them until they become waste, cluttering up our homes. The solution is to make it as easy to sell as it is to buy. We spent 5 years developing and testing a system that's ready to launch. People find their items on their site, click sell, and collect their cash from a local retailer. It's that easy. We handle pricing, products, training, testing, development, and hosting, so the retailer can get back to what they're best at, focusing on the customer. My team currently consists of 4 individuals. Myself, providing the driving force and direction. David, who's been valuing items for us since 2012. Carl, who's ex-army, with 6 years B2B and B2C sales experience. My developer, who custom coded the platform from scratch with me since 2010. We have huge room for growth and are in talks with both learning providers and the Prince's Trust to provide placements for work-based learning. Our distinct advantage is our ability to coexist in harmony with our competition. Boot sale sites like Gumtree and Spock help us to identify the next profitable items to add to our system. And marketplaces such as eBay and Amazon benefit from more listing from experienced retail professionals. Another advantage is our ability to scale. This is only phase one. We have 3 years of advanced development already built and ready to roll out to make it even easier for people to sell. This is a downhill project. The more retailers we sign up, the more value each retailer gets out of the system. The world is crying out for our service. People already have items wasting away in their homes, and our service is free for them to use. Physical retailers are in desperate need of support and ways to bring in more local business. Amazon and eBay want more quality control and guaranteed stock levels so they can capitalize on same-day delivery. Our platform is built, ready to launch, and has the ability to scale quickly to other countries worldwide, creating a huge positive effect on the environment. Not only that, but our business makes money. Lots of it. We have a range of options from pay-as-you-go monthly subscriptions to pay-as-you-go packages so retailers can find a plan that is right for them. Pay monthly plans give the best value overall, include a retailer microsite, a set number of staff, products, and transactions. When a retailer hits their transaction limit, they simply purchase more credits from our self-service platform. This is only the start of monetization available to the Get Paid platform. Phase 2 monetization begins when we hit our first target of 200 stores. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Oscar, and very, very good for time. There's going to be lots of questions, I promise you, about your financials and your growth projections. I might have missed it, and I apologize if I did, but who's the seller and who's the buyer in this equation on your platform?
So Get Paid is the place where you sell items before they go back onto the marketplace. So what we're doing is we're providing a system for retailers so that your average consumer that has an item can simply look up its value wherever they are in the country, click sell and be directed to a local retailer that will receive that order and process that and give them the cash for it straight away so that they don't have to deal with a boot sale site or putting things on the marketplace.
Okay. And your payment model in that is what?
Where do we make our money?
Yeah.
So we make our money from providing the services directly to the retailers.
Okay.
We make it so that they don't have to handle any of this stuff. I mean, going through this process, I had retail stores myself, and I saw how hard it was for retailers to turn any kind of profit in what they're doing because they're having to keep up with the big boys, they're having to implement all of these systems, they're having to train their staff, they're having to watch everything that they're doing and focus on trying to market their business and get to customers. We want to provide them with everything that they need in the platform so that they can keep up running momentum and focus on their local customers and creating good relationships because that's what store owners should do.
Just so I'm perfectly clear, if I was wanting to sell, say, the last season of Game of Thrones on Blu-ray, I would put it up there, I could look up a price, a local retailer could essentially buy that from me, and they would then list it on Amazon?
So the end retailer would sell it how they normally sell it, so they'd either list it back in their store, on their website, or on Amazon and eBay. But what we're doing is we're cataloguing, we realise that there's millions of products out there, that it's 2016 and nobody knows the value of the items that we own. So that's the core problem that we're addressing. Yeah. We're making it so that over time, everyone will know when they buy an item, what their item is worth. We're starting on a huge backlog and we're starting with the world's most popular items. So we're starting with the mobile phones, the jewelry, the tech, the designer clothing, the stuff that people have en masse. We're putting them up on the site and the system, and we're letting people know if you want to sell these things, they have a value now that's now being tracked. We then check all of the boot sale apps and stuff for popular items. We then add them to our database and we track the prices. Now a retailer that's a buy and sell store no longer has to put their own prices up and maintain them. They can just subscribe to our system, subscribe to the price that they want to buy for, And if it matches it, they become available on the site as a vendor to then sell that product. We map out the areas all over the UK, starting from London. And when someone wants to sell something, they go to getpaid.co.uk, just like a Just Eat model. You either go to Just Eat or into the retailer's microsite that the retailer would offer, and you can just process your sale. You can see what that independent store has that they can buy in, the value of that, and if you've got one of those items, get your cash for it straight away.
Thank you.
So there's nowhere that the person who's buying it ultimately can see a photograph of the actual thing they're buying?
Oh, so we're not even dealing with that process. We're just helping consumers value and sell so that when somebody wants to get rid of an item, they don't have to go through the process of selling it to a stranger, listing up on a marketplace, taking a picture, or selling it on eBay and hoping that it sells.
Who's going to see the picture of what I'm selling? Well, because maybe what I'm selling doesn't look as nice as what somebody else...
This is the great thing. There doesn't even have to be a picture. You simply find the item on the site. So just say if it's this mobile phone, you search, you say, I've got an iPhone 6. You go to getpaid.co.uk, you type in iPhone 6. There it is. There's a picture of it. That's the one that I've got. You get £200 for that. Oh, I'd like to sell that now. I click sell. That order now goes to a local store that's near to you. You get a confirmation message just saying, pop around the corner, drop off your phone,
you drop
pick
it off,
up your
though,
cash.
And they take a look at it and they say, blimey, this hasn't been well looked after.
So we've got three grades.
Okay.
We've got new, we keep it simple, new, working and faulty. If it fits in the working category, then you're guaranteed for that price.
Okay.
If it's a faulty category, we have the faulty price, and we maintain all of the different criteria that would stick you in the grade, so that when you're looking at the site, when you click sell, you know which grade that you're selling.
Okay.
And we provide all of the training and tools for the staff within the stores to be able to handle that, and they get accredited with a little badge from us, so that the person that owns and runs the business knows that the people that are dealing with the orders are qualified to do so and can handle everything.
Okay.
For them.
Alistair, just to, in terms of the numbers, you know, how many users have you got? What sales have you got?
So we're doing this pitch right in line with our launch.
Okay.
So for 2016, the target is for 200 stores. And we quickly realised that if we managed to get Waterloo Station, we'd be able to leverage that and then hit our targets even sooner. So that's what we're really going for. We're really going for the advertising to leverage that off of the back of it. As soon as I heard about the competition, we started late. We started on the 22nd of April, got to hustling the streets because I knew that if I could get as high as I can in the competition, that I'd get people on board. Got my sales guy on board, and like, he's calling every day, people warmly saying, look, we're doing great in the competition, this is what we do, and this is just the next step. So really, the whole process all the way through is just accelerating what we're doing to get us there faster.
But you've been developing this advanced platform for 3 years, four people. You must have a 3 to 5 year plan. So how big's this company that you're going to be running?
It's, I'm planning, in my mind, when I started in 2010, I had my mindset that I didn't want to sell, I wanted to build a company up from scratch to £300 million. So that's my minimum level that I want to get a company to. But since expanding on the company and what this can be and what this can do to change the world, we're in England now. This can go to, the system is there. It can be rolled out once it's proven here to other developed countries and really do a world of wonder for anyone that needs to sell anything. Taking
so
the hassle out of selling.
Million, is that a valuation or is that revenue?
Oh, no, that's just a personal goal I have for myself that I want to achieve.
As a revenue target
just if I was to IPO a company or if I was to sell out a buyout, that's the minimum target that I set myself for in terms of achieving a personal goal.
Yes, the competition you mentioned, some of these guys are reasonably well established and they do set markers around the market set for the price and the market sets how these things should sell. The margin is small when you're selling second-hand goods.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you address that? Or is it the convenience of being able to move it quickly through a local retailer?
That's what we have. We have the pricing department to do that, to help the retailer do that. And what we actually end up doing is representing the retailer to the marketplaces so they get everything that they needed. Running the retail stores, we learned, for instance, that disbursements from Amazon take typically 14 days. We managed to get ours down to 5 days.
Okay.
And this is something that we'd be doing for the retailers to help them keep that flow, to keep their margins and all the products they're selling to create a working system.
Okay.
Thank you.
Alistair, well done.
Thank you so much.
I love your ambition. 300 million. Good for you. And you're off and running.
Yeah.
So we shall look forward to seeing you grow enormously. Well done.
Perfect.
Well
done. Well done. Thank you, guys. You're doing great.
Cheers. Cheers. We'll see you later.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ade, and I'm the founder of Vossade.com. The African fashion industry is estimated at £25 billion, yet less than 2% of African fashion designers trade globally. The average tailor in Africa earns about £3,000 per year. A few years ago, I attempted to move to Africa, and despite the fact that I'd moved with everything, including my kitchen sink, I very quickly found that I had run out of clothes. It was devastating. Being in Africa, where I could go to so many places and I didn't have enough clothes. What was even more devastating was that I couldn't access quality clothing at affordable prices. Fast forward 2 years down the line, I attended one of the largest trade shows in Europe. I remember walking into the arena completely dismayed at the number of Western fashion brands seeking buyers. I mean, there were so many of them that the only logical place to hold such an event was an airport that was no longer in use. As I walked out of the arena that day, the one question that constantly played in my mind was, if there were these many fashion brands on the globe, why couldn't I access them from Africa? I spoke to a few people, we ran a few surveys, and the feedback was overwhelmingly positive, but the one thing people wanted to see was African brands trading globally. Vossade.com is an online platform that is not just focused on bringing Western fashion brands to Africa, but also about empowering African entrepreneurs by giving them a global platform on which they can sell on. The Vossade management team consists of three individuals, all of who have very strong financial and investment banking backgrounds. I personally have worked at Credit Suisse and KPMG. My business partners have worked at Deutsche Bank and BNP Paribas. We know Africa. We understand global markets. But more importantly, we know that we're cognizant with the reality of doing business on the continent. We're passionate about this. We're passionate about doing good. We're passionate about profitability. And we're passionate about having fun while we do it. Africa as a continent is set to boom. By 2025, the population of Africa is estimated to be 1.4 billion people. And also, consumer spending is set to rise to $1.4 trillion. I don't know if any of you know what Losode means. Losode is an African word that means let's go out. We're asking Vroom to come out with us, to smash trade borders, to disrupt the global fashion industry, but more importantly, to empower African entrepreneurs by giving them a platform that they can trade on globally. Thank you.
Thank you so much, and well pitched.
Thank you.
Some questions.
Yes.
The import and export, if you're kind of looking at the business model and your platform, do you see it predominantly about money of Western goods into Africa, or the other way around? What would you see the balance of your intent for the platform?
I think, given the number of fashion designers, I mean, so looking at the balance, I'd probably say Western brands coming into Africa, a 60% split in terms of, because people, Africans wear Western brands to work every day. I mean, the African designs are a bit more flamboyant, they're a bit rarer. We wear them to our amazing events and big parties. So I see definitely Western brands hitting Africa a lot more. However, the 40%, even though it's 40% in terms of, well, you can't really work them out because revenue-wise, the models are different in the way that they meet our revenue predictions. The Western element is a lot more profitable, but the African element, we could suddenly have numbers and have a lot of people very quickly.
Mm.
But definitely I see more Western brands going into Africa.
Okay. Thank you.
So with the three of you, who's going to decide what brands go on your fashion platform?
So none of us. So I'm the founder, Ade, and I tend to look at the strategy. I have an operations banker who's a business manager, and she will look at operations as a whole. But we will work with buyers, experienced people who understand what is selling, What brands come on the platform is extremely strategic. So I'm assuming you're talking about the retail element of the business, which is Western brands to Africa.
Yeah.
That's extremely strategic,
yeah.
How we make that decision. It is what is selling. Do they meet our price point? And so we work with buyers who actually know what's trending, what would go off the shelves quickly. We have to be very, very strategic as to how we manage that aspect because we are carrying stock.
Yeah.
Okay, can I just ask a question about how you're going to actually bring this new online platform to market and how you're going to kind of advertise it to people? Because I guess that's one of the key challenges, how you're going to get kind of the traffic to get the conversion you would need.
Okay, so we're definitely, so going into the African audience, I mean, so there's 1 billion people in Africa, 67% of those have mobile phones. So it'd be very important for us to work with the big telco companies to get the message out via mobile phones. Also, people tend to use their mobile phones for the internet. So the one thing that we've made sure is that the Losode platform fits the mobile devices excellently. You can complete a whole transaction on your mobile phone because we understand the market that we're going into. Also, we have 50 million Africans on Facebook. Again, that would be a good a platform that we will leverage on social media. Twitter isn't as popular, but Facebook definitely. And also, we will use radio. If any of you have ever been on the continent, you know the amount of time that's spent in traffic. And so it will be to pick out strategic slots on radio.
Thank you.
It sounds to me that there's an element where you can promote African designers and local skills back out yes. of Africa through the site. Is that fair to say?
Yes, and that's a bit that I'm most passionate about. It's about giving African fashion designers a platform to serve a global audience. At the moment, we have people bringing up beautiful things, beautiful fashion designers that can't expand in the market because they're just... It's so crowded and there's no outlet or expression. So we think that this platform would not only empower people, it would also bring a connection. We'll smash some trade borders. We expect that we will disrupt the industry. And the fantastic thing about the model is it can be rolled out to other developing countries as well.
Very exciting. Very good. Adi, I love the brand name. It's fantastic.
Thank you.
And I love your passion for the idea of taking some of these... really skilled people and taking their skills outside of Africa.
You
know, if you had to decide, you know, which way you were going to take the business and you could only either export from Africa or into Africa, which would you do?
I wouldn't. I think both elements do have their value. Coming into Africa is extremely risky, but the model has been done by people like ASOS and Net-a-Porter, where Western fashion brands have carried stock and sold to markets at a markup of 240 to 270%. It's an extremely profitable venture. There are ways you can hedge your risk there. But we're also very passionate about doing business for good. We're passionate about helping people and empowering entrepreneurs, and I think that's important. So I'm really sorry I couldn't make a choice. I have thought about it a few times, and I thought we don't really want to be like Etsy, where we lose the value of the retail market. People in Africa do need access to Western fashion brands.
I mean, building on that question, which you mentioned, these are Sunetta Portley. So on that import into Africa, that's already an existing set of competitors, so why are you different than them?
So ASOS does it, but not as well as we will do it. We know Africa. We know what works, what makes people tick. A simple example, it's easy to assume that because Africa is hot, people would want things that are sleeveless and short dresses, and that would sell more. But I know from experience and from carrying out surveys in the market, people want things that are long-sleeved and covered up because there's a cultural element to that. As African women, we're taught to be modest, dress moderately. You can't, I mean, Africa is sort of an environment that if you went to work in a pair of shorts, no matter how formal they look, you will be sent home.
And I'm playing a little bit of devil's advocate. You think ASOS and Net-a-Porter don't know that? You think they're a bit blind to that?
I think they do, but I think they also have the added advantage of the UK markets. And it's like us being online, right? We aren't limited by any barriers or boundaries. Anybody anywhere that can pay on our platform and we can deliver to them can access our site and make a sale. But our primary target is Africa, whereas ASOS's primary target is the UK. And
gotcha.
Rest of the world.
Some numbers?
Sorry,
number
one.
Super quick number. What is the number that you're aiming for your turnover in year one?
So in year one, we're looking at a revenue of 1.6 million.
In year one?
Yes.
Okay.
Three and five,
yeah.
Quickly.
Year 3, 15.1 million. We haven't projected out to year 5. We've only projected out to
year 3. And what's your net profit?
Our net profit, so we become profitable in year 2 at... so our net profit is about 7.5 million.
In year 3?
In year 3. We break even in Q2 of year 3.
Fantastic. So congratulations.
Thank you.
I think you're into a huge market, and bold and brave and passionate, and you know, I love the fact you want to balance, and you wouldn't answer that question, which says you're going to stick to your guns. So congratulations and well done.
Thank you very much. It means a lot. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Bye.
One in four people in the UK is living with at least one long-term condition. In the States, that rises to one in three. The cost of care accounts to 30% of health and social spending. Around 50% of people globally don't take their medication as prescribed, and that costs the USA alone $290 billion annually. But harnessing today's social use of technology provides a brand new solution. Let's talk about my friend Mike, the founder, who has Parkinson's. Now, I call him up. How have you been this week, I ask? Well, I've been all right, I guess. I'm not sleeping well, but I'm fine. How much more powerful would it be if I could ring up Mike and say, I seen you haven't been sleeping very well. You've only taken half of your meds, and you haven't been out of the house for 3 days. What's wrong? And he says, well, the medication the doctor gave me recently isn't working very well. It makes me feel nauseous, so I've stopped taking it. You see, Mike and I are both using a platform called myHealthPal, or MHP for short. Mike takes 18 different pills every day, and those medications interact with one another. But with only 12 and a half minutes with his consultant every 5.5 months, tracking their effectiveness and, importantly, their interaction is a huge ask. So is this just an alarm clock to help him take his meds? MHP is so much more than that. It also includes tools to track symptoms, like Parkinson's tremors using the clever little accelerometers in our phones. And by linking with wearable tech, can monitor sleep and exercise, all of which turns into user-friendly visuals that encourages Mike's adherence. Now, here's the really clever bit. MHP's Care Circle allows patients to choose to share data with carers, making medical consultations more effective and interventions more timely, reducing costs in healthcare and insurance. Part of our vision is to allow patients to share anonymized, real-world data with research institutions to better understand medication interaction on real people and to accelerate research to improve patient outcomes. We're on the brink of the perfect storm of success for MHP. People with long-term conditions are now of a generation au fait with smartphones, and wearable tech provides more and more data. Our next version adds support for diabetes, HIV, MS, ME, and a whole lot more to add. Importantly, the health developments at Apple and Google will enable MHP to further connect with the medical, pharmaceutical, and insurance industries. Finally, we have an experienced team of experts able to successfully launch and have developed a robust business model, enabling us to raise almost £600,000 to date. We're looking to generate £1.9 million in sales next year, rising to £17 million in 2019 through four distinct business-to-business revenue streams.
Well done, Ralph.
Ralph, super job.
Well done.
Wow, and sort of good on time. There's going to be lots of questions about the tech, I'm sure. I'm just going to go straight to the revenue, if that's okay. You said about four different revenue streams. So tell me about the breakdown of those revenue streams.
Absolutely. They're care, healthcare, insurance, and research. So the care it's always going to be free to the user. So that's the key, that the app and the interface is free to the user. The carer subscription is, so if you have a loved one or somebody you're taking care of and you want to subscribe to the app. The healthcare side is giving access to healthcare professionals to in-home test results and adherence data so that doctors can actually monitor people. Insurance, looking at a per user license fee, and that's about driving down insurance premiums for the individual. So as long as they're adhering to their medication, insurance companies would do that. And then the really big one, and this is the important one, is the big data side of it. Pharma and research bodies and charities will pay for that aggregated data, which is anonymized. And just to give you the where we get the 1.9 million in the first year of sales, we've already spoken to a lot of pharma companies and research bodies who are very interested in this data, because it's not a clinical trial, it's a massive real-world trial, so it does drug interaction, not just individuals. And they figure that they would pay about $400 per data set. Now, data set is one person for their data for the year. We'd only need 7,600 users to turn that into the money that we're talking about, and we've already got 1,500 people who've downloaded and are using the app without doing any. It's a beta on the App Store. We haven't done any PR marketing around it.
Okay. Gotcha.
Do you think that your users are going to be happy to have their data shared, even though it says, you know, it's going to be anonymous, you can't track it back? Isn't there that kind of, like, reluctance to have your health data passed on to a pharma company?
Yeah, I agree. And I think what's really important is what we've done is we've gone for the American model first because it's more restrictive. And we've got HIPAA certification already, which is the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, which is the standard around privacy and security of data. So we're already compliant with that. And I think when you look at people, we're trying to incentivize the data because there's a selfish reason for people, but there's also the altruistic reason behind it. If they are diagnosed with a long-term condition, let's take Parkinson's, because that's what we're talking about at the moment. If you're diagnosed, like Mike was at the age of 41, one, you can give data knowing that that helps the research for looking at, you know, better health outcomes for people. But also from a selfish point of view, you're young enough to think that it might help you too. So I think at the other side of it, we're also incentivizing them financially because we're giving 20% of any profit in the data donation to a charity of that person's choice. So say it was Parkinson's UK or HIV, the Terence Higgins Trust or whatever.
Okay. Can I just ask, so you said you've had 1,500 people download the app so far. What's the engagement been like so far? Kind of how sticky is it? Because I know I've tried a few different kind of platforms for tracking medication, symptoms, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I do tend to kind of drop off, try something different.
Yeah. It's I haven't got real hard data on that.
Okay.
It's you know, we're not really trying to push it at the moment, so we're just trying to get people to use it and be used to it. But yeah, to be frank, I don't know the answer to that question.
Okay. I guess what do you think you could do? Or what is the hook that's going to keep them updating data kind of day after day, consistently, accurately for a year?
I think the key is that it actually helps them on a day-to-day basis. So they can do the like for Parkinson's, they can do the tests using the app.
Yeah.
Then they can take the medication, then they can do the test again an hour later and see how that medication has affected their condition. So it's almost gamifying it in a weird sort of way.
Yeah.
It's almost like, oh, let's see how that medication worked. And I think that's the hook that'll get people to continue using it.
Ralph, I love the business. I think it's really exciting and it's a critical area that we're facing some big challenges in. My real question here is I suppose related back to, you know, how you keep people involved.
Mm.
But I think the more important thing is assume that we've solved that problem. You've got the answer.
Yeah.
What's stopping you from being, you know, a bigger business going forward?
What's stopping us?
Yeah, what do you need now?
At the moment, £30,000. We could have the care circles and the rest of the infrastructure built. We haven't launched yet, so we're right at that critical point where about £30,000 would get us the coders to finish everything off and launch properly, or have a product to launch properly in about 3 months' time.
Okay.
I've invested personally £40,000. Other people, it's all been done by mini angels, you know, people like me who are just really sold on the idea. I put in the majority of my flat deposit because I think it's a really good business. So it's getting people like me who really like it, who are saying, you know, I'm going to put some money behind this because I think it'll work.
Great.
So again, I think it's standout as well. I think it's really, really interesting. Is there anything proprietary in there? Is there anything that the system or service does that can be tagged to the business and not easily copied?
To be frank, I'm not sure. I don't understand the tech well enough.
Okay.
I should just say, Mike, who designed it, the guy with Parkinson's, is in New York tonight pitching with the Michael J. Fox Foundation, so that's why he's not here and I'm here.
Yeah.
So he could answer a lot of those sort of questions. I'm afraid I'm not techy enough to really know the answer to that.
To build on the question, though, because you mentioned companies like Apple and others getting into this kind of health space.
Yeah.
So where is the threat come to your business from big either medical companies or tech companies saying we wouldn't mind a slice of this?
Yeah, I mean, we don't see Apple and Google as competition. We see them as actually enabling us because they're pushing this concept so much that people are starting to get used to it, having the health app on their phone. So we can link into all those things. If they decide to come in and do it, yeah, they probably could, but it'd take them a while. Because it takes a long time to get HIPAA certification, all these different things that have been... We've been building a really robust back-end on the tech side. One statistic that sticks out in my mind, we can have 100,000 simultaneous logins and it won't crash. So it's very, very robust. It's been built from the bottom up as a foundation rather than just launching something and then trying to figure out how it works behind it. So that's kind of how we're dealing with it. It's
great.
Yeah.
I really like that it holds in a pal, a secondary person, because there's I think that long-term illness can has its own other difficulties other than maintaining meds and timescales. So somebody else watching over that, I think, could be really important.
Yeah, I mean, it feeds into, you know, somebody who's taking care of their mother and or their great aunt, and instead of having to figure out what's wrong with them, they can actually look at data and say, okay, they're not sleeping.
We're going to be called on time, Rolf. So, first of all, good pitch. You pitched hard. We asked a lot of questions there, so we're over on question time. But I think you're in a huge space in market size, and you've got all of the right ingredients there. So congratulations getting into this far, and great job today.
Thank you.
Amazing non-invasive penile support device. StaySard facilitates successful intercourse by holding the penis erect and is for men who suffer from erectile dysfunction and premature ejaculation. StaySard was developed by myself over the last years and with help from urologists and Professor Peter Ford of De Montfort University, who is one of the country's leading gurus and specializes in the development of medical devices. StaySard is truly the answer for a problem that affects millions of men worldwide. In fact, in the United Kingdom, there are over 10 million men suffer from erectile dysfunction. StaySard is truly the answer for this problem. When a man loses his potency, he can feel he's lost his life. So what are the current options today? Costly pills like Viagra and the like. They do take time to effect. And of course, they have side effects. And many, for many men, they don't work at all. There are injections and pumps, and they can take some time to work. And there are also related issues with them as well. And at the top end, and very costly, costing about £8,000 to £10,000, are operations for penile implants. We think the last option is the saddest one of all. You just have to refrain from a sexual relationship. And we've all read in the press about, you know, well-known empresarios and leaders who have had major problems. StaySard has been test-driven by over 30 men and their partners also, with excellent results. It's quick and easy to use, and it aids spontaneity. It's durable and lasts for up to 6 months, and practically imperceptible for the man using it and his partner. StaySard is made in the UK. We've registered the design patents in the USA and for the whole of the EC. I have successfully developed and sold many health-related products and electronic products for over 30 years, and that followed a successful retail career in the UK and overseas. I'm supported by my two sons, one of whom is a senior consultant for EY, and the other who's an investment banker with Goldman Sachs. As well as the help and advice, continuing from the medical experts I've already mentioned, I have personally suffered from some debilitating prostate problems, and I sought to seek the solution, and I believe Stays Hard is truly the answer for this major problem. Certainly with the help of Virgin Media, we will be able to help many men and their partners also. Thank you.
So, Richard, thank you. Thank you for your presentation. We're good on time. So, some questions.
Thank you.
I guess, sizing the market, you mentioned about 10 million men in the UK. Tell me about how you see the size of your market, about how much of that market you can get to. Is it UK to begin with? Have you got global aspirations? Just give me a sense of volume. Value might be difficult because I guess you're a substitution market in that sense. So,
well, I can give you some values.
Okay.
It's 10 million men in the UK.
Yeah.
And that affects lots of age groups. The percentage breakdown is simple. In the age group of the 20-year plus, it's about 7%. In the 30-year age group, it's about 11%. But for men over the age of 40, we're really talking about 50% of all men will suffer from erectile dysfunction. About a third of all men will suffer at some time from premature ejaculation. We have our product which helps solve all the problems. It's non-invasive, as I've said as well. And we can retail this at a cost of around about £39.50. That's an initial launch price. The cost of the product delivered, including postage, wire coatings, all sorts of things, is around about £10. In direct costs, that's marketing, we will also have to register the product as a medical device, which we've already had the information from our medical experts. It's quite simple to get. Will cost about £5,000 to the EU and USA. The total of about £15,000. Our forecast, if we only had 0.01% of the market, would give us a revenue stream in the UK of about just under £400,000. So the direct cost of producing, let's say the 10,000 units, the 0.1%, would mean that we'd have direct costs of 100,000. This would give us a gross margin of nearly 300,000, and we'd have an income before tax of just over £284,000. So it's a massive size in the market. It's a massive worldwide. In 2 years ago, the figures from Pfizer for Viagra product, there were 1.7 million prescriptions written in the UK alone. Take that, extrapolate that worldwide, it's absolutely massive.
So you've got some great numbers
there.
Yeah,
can I just pick up on that point about kind of Viagra being prescribed?
Yes.
So what is the route to market for this, and who are likely to be paying for it? Is it something, if it's classified as a medical device, that can also be prescribed?
Well, our product is something that can sit on the shelves of a pharmacy. It could be on a rack. It could be on the Amazon platform. Other health products I've sold have followed the same route. We've been in pharmacists. We have been on the Amazon platform. We've had the highest selling level of any weight loss product as well. Another thing we had
so
in the UK.
Kind of more a retail model as opposed to kind of...
It's more a retail model, correct.
Okay.
Yeah, you could see this in your supermarket because if you walk in, there are sexual related products.
Yep.
Condoms, everything else. And by the way, when we talk about condoms, I also would advocate, and we'll say in our instructions here, if you're in a monogamous relationship, this is quite reusable. If you're in a relationship that's perhaps not so much and you have maybe multiple partners, well, you could use this quite simply in conjunction with a condom as well.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm sort of a bit caught up on the same issue, the medical issue. Have there been any sort of doctors or what medical people have been involved in?
Well, as I've said, we've had some pretty famous urologists from the UK and overseas, and we've worked with Professor Peter Ford at De Montfort University in Leicester, who is, as I said, one of the gurus, really, of medical design products. We have got a product that simply works so well. It's a simple solution. It's cost-effective. It's non-invasive. I mean, there are a lot of products in the marketplace of all sorts, pharmacological products, and there's a lot of products that are sex aids. This is really imperceptible to use for both the male partner and, the person using the product. It's hardly noticeable. It fits the contours of the penis. It's... Yeah. Yes, of course.
Have you actually engaged with any of the customers, retail customers, to talk about their thoughts on
We've been at this all day. No, we started at 1
right.
Or have you looked at licensing or something
on the major
Well, that's an interesting fact. As I said, one of my sons is a Goldman Sachs executive and the other's with EY. There is the potential to franchise, license, all sorts of things worldwide. One of our users is someone I was connected with in business in Canada. Yeah.
The question I'm asking is, what's actually stopping you taking it forward now? The numbers are really clear, the market's well-sized. What's the blocker from taking it from what you have at the moment to actually bringing it to market and trialing it, selling it?
We're there with the design of the product. It's simple. We're there also to ensure that we can roll out vast numbers. It's simple to do. We've talked with the medical experts, we've talked with Professor Peter Ford. It enables us to reach every country and a vast target market.
Okay.
Thank you.
Richard, we've run out of time. Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you very much
indeed. Well pitched and well answered.
Thank you so much.
I wish you every success. Well done.
Well, I'm passionate about it. Thank you very much indeed. Yeah, get out.
Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you.
Okay.
Good morning. Hi, my name is Toby James. I'm a consultant eye surgeon from Yorkshire. This is the Eyebag, a simple medical device. It actually treats dry eye, which is a massive problem affecting 20% of the population. Tiny oil glands in the eyelids get blocked up, and this is called meibomian gland dysfunction, or MGD. Major feature of dry eye. It's made worse by our modern lifestyle, staring at screens all day. Eye drops and sprays may help, but they don't treat MGD, and what you need is an effective warm compress to unblock these glands. Eye care practitioners often tell patients to use a hot, wet flannel, but DIY compresses are messy and useless, and nobody does it. So I invented the Eyebag to solve this problem. Made of silk and cotton and filled with flax, it heats in the microwave to the correct temperature and stays warm for just the right length of time. Because it's easy and pleasant to use, patient compliance is absolutely excellent. People say this has changed their lives. The Eyebag is made, packed and dispatched in West Yorkshire. We have a small, efficient team, all the necessary skills and a secure supply chain with scalable production, which is good because the dry eye market is truly massive, worth $3.2 billion last year and predicted to reach $4.5 billion by 2020. Worldwide, 350 million people suffer from dry eye, 100 million in Europe and 60 million in America. Although most of the eye bags are sold through UK opticians or online, international sales account for 10% of our turnover currently. The Eyebag has several stunning advantages. It's the first and only warm eye compress on prescription anywhere in the world. Credible peer-reviewed research from international authors confirms it's safe and effective as a treatment for dry eye, and we recently got FDA registration in the US. We've sold over 500,000, Feedback's overwhelmingly positive, and in response to customer demand, we've just launched Eyebag Instant, a single-use disposable warm compress, and you may want to tear one open. It'll take 3 minutes to warm up. We have the patent, we have trademarks, we have a product that works, and we have built a trusted brand. So our financial situation is solid, and we have a profitable business model. The NHS tariff price is set at £10, and the Eyebag usually retails at £20. Last year, our turnover was £730,000 on sales of 90,000 Eyebags, with an EBITDA of 40%. We've got no loans or debts, and the business is growing. So right now, the Eyebag company is perfectly poised to go boom.
Toby, well done, and thank you for bringing some stuff to for us to play with as we're chatting to you and asking you questions. Oh, it sounds like you've got a lot of the things kind of nailed. You talked about patent. You've sold 500,000 already. Just tell me where you've sold them and through who.
Okay, so when I first started about 11 years ago, this was so off the wall in the eye world that I went to my local opticians in Halifax and my local and said, would you please sell these for me? And they looked at me as though I was bonkers, but they gave it a go, and we got word of mouth around West Yorkshire, and people realised after a year or 2 years, because people came back after a year, and they said, well, how's your dry eye? And the people said, what dry eye? And the optician said, well, you've got dry eye, you know, it's a lifelong condition. And they said, well, you gave me that thing last year and it got better, so what's the issue? So it took a year or two for opticians to realise that it worked, and then they spread it by word of mouth. So most of our sales are through high street opticians in the UK, all sorts, some of the multiples. It's up to each individual spec savers whether they stock them or not. Lots of independent optometrists sell it. There are pharmaceutical and optical wholesalers. So we sell in bulk to optical wholesalers and they distribute to all the optometrists. But we have lots of people who buy directly from us. And we export about 10% of our turnover is due to exports. Countries like Poland. Interesting, we did a UKTI thing in Poland. I put on a symposium at the British Embassy for Warsaw ophthalmologists, organised it with the lady Mariola who runs UKTI in Warsaw, rang her up, said, I'd like to do this, and she said, great, let's do it. So lots of different routes to market.
Thank you. Just the one piece I missed in that was how many through prescription?
At the moment, we only got it on prescription October last year.
Okay,
and that was a mammoth event for us because to get something on prescription, and it's a completely new category, right? There are 77 different types of eye drops on prescription for dry eye in the UK. And as a doctor, you know, when there are 77 treatments for something, none of them work, okay? If there was one that worked...
We're going to run out of time and I won't have any questions to ask. Sorry, can I just jump in? Can you do your numbers again? So,
yes.
Like, last year, this year...
Sorry, 730,000 turnover, 90,000 sales, average selling price £8.
Looking forward, where do you see the growth in the business coming from? Is
okay.
It expanding more into your international markets, and how important is that FDA approval?
The first thing is that the UK prescriptions for the bog standard eye drop, there were 4 million last year. And if you give those for 6 months, it costs over £10. And the price for us is cheaper, and ours lasts for 6 months. So it's actually cheaper than the cheapest eye drop over a six-month period, and it actually treats the condition. So 4 million prescriptions for that, I would and those are just the prescription ones. Those are not ones people buy over the counter.
Yeah.
So the likelihood is that you're going to have... I'd like to take a photo. Can I do that? The likelihood is that you're going to have 4 to 5 million prescriptions over the next year or two, and it will grow organically out from the UK, but I'm a fellow of the member of the American Academy of Ophthalmology, so I think that the US FDA registration is going to be a massive thing for us.
So, well done on the pitch.
Thank you.
Love the product. I think it obviously being very well modelled by my co-judge here. I can see him on the path.
You need to give a little massage now, Andrew. Just like that.
We'll try that later.
Yeah.
You mentioned in your presentation your patent.
Yes.
What claims have you got and what territory?
So we have a UK patent for a medical device for the treatment of meibomian gland dysfunction, and I have had to defend it the year before last, and successfully, and I have the patent through till 2024. It was filed in December 2004, granted in 2009, and it's through till 2024. Having defended it, we're likely to be much more secure. So we have a European patent application, which remains open and is under examination, but it's been not rushed through. We haven't got a US patent, but we do have the brand. And what's really important for us from brand purposes is all the published literature on the randomized controlled trials showing it works, and all the medical journal evidence is both the brand and the product. So it carries through.
So, really interesting product and a great pitch.
Thanks, Gary.
Do you know what you need to do in order to scale it from 730K to 7 million? Are the skills within the team, or is that something you're hoping to get through this process?
That's something I'm hoping to acquire through this process. We want the oxygen of publicity, but what I would really love is advice and help from the system.
Okay, so that should be forthcoming, because it's that magic line, and you could 10x this with the... with the right team, with the right model.
That would be
really
lovely.
Great product.
Thank you very much indeed.
So you've been very, very patient you've been going at this for many, many years.
That's because I'm still working 3 days a week as a consultant eye surgeon. And the company secretary is a consultant radiologist, and she works 3 days a week as well. So we've gently.
So when you say you're ready to voom,
mm-hmm.
roll the movie forward 5 years,
mm-hmm.
how big?
Probably about 20 million sales in Europe and equal in the States, 40 million a year, £8 a pop, probably go less for the volume, £6, £6/8, £4 to £4/8, 240 million.
240 million. Congratulations. Thank you. Brilliant pitch. Well done.
Wonderful.
Excellent job.
And thank you very much.
You have to
take these away. Well, please give them back. Well, is it warmed up for you?
That was actually very, very comforting.
Good.
Thank you for that.
I haven't really talked about the incident at all.
It's very warm, actually.
Thank you very much.
Super job.
Well, good morning. I'm a chartered accountant, and I've been a consultant with KPMG and EY for 20-odd years. I've moved with them from Mumbai to London, and then from London to Dubai. Every time I moved, I felt like a boy in a new school. I had left all my business contacts behind, I'd left all my social contacts behind, and I was going into a new culture. And when I went to Dubai, in a country which speaks an entirely different language, I was alone, and I felt depressed after a point. According to HSBC, there are almost 50 million other expats, white-collar expats around the world. And according to McKinsey and Mercer, a full 70% of them feel lonely, isolated, and find it difficult to make new friends and understand the new culture. And that is where I spotted an opportunity, and I created the Expats Club. I started off by just creating groups using online social platforms and organizing weekly business networking and socializing events. We did a whole range of events, so it wasn't just sort of cocktails or whatever else. We would have cruises, we would have hikes, we would have treks, we would have gala balls, we would have all kinds, a wide variety, which would meet the needs of all our members. What we also did was, you know, welcome people warmly. We tried to understand what they did, what their interests were, and then connected them to other expats and internationally minded locals who were within our membership. What this meant is these people who were feeling lonely and sort of depressed for a while after they had moved into this new country suddenly had a social network and a professional network that they could rely on. And in addition, what we did was we introduced them to all, you know, trusted service providers that they're going to need, such as car leasing companies, such as reputed doctors and dentists locally, such as travel agents, such as financial advisors, because these are all people that expats are going to require. And you know, having started from there, before we knew it, we have 40,000 members and operate in 5 cities. Our business model is very simple. Much of our revenue at the moment comes from event attendance fees and commissions from the services which are purchased by our members from the various trusted advisors and suppliers that we introduce them to. Going forward, we plan to introduce membership fees. So maybe a de minimis number, probably £1 a month membership fee for everyone who's part of our network. Revenue in 2015, the past 12 months, was $100,000 from 25,000 members, mainly in Dubai and Abu Dhabi. This year, the 12 months forward, are going to be $200,000 coming from Dubai, Abu Dhabi, and London, Singapore, and Doha, which have sort of grown to a point where they are profitable or generate revenue. As you would appreciate, creating a network initially is almost purely investment. And about 3 months into creating the network, when you have a critical size, it's sort of self-perpetuating and it keeps growing once people in it find value. And profitability is very high because we don't really have any significant fixed costs. And it's sort of all marginal costs, and that is sort of fairly minimal. I aim to, by 2018, that's 3 years forward, get to $1.5 million with 250,000 members in 20 cities. Now, our team, as I say, is very small. I lead it, and what I have are people, other expatriates who work with me part-time in each of these 5 cities where we operate. They help me manage events. They look after our membership. There are also expats who have been there for a little longer than the newer ones, so they're able to share knowledge and share information about various service providers.
Any questions and comments, please?
Okay, we'll help you. Sounds like you had more go. So I get your financial numbers. You talk about the members and the service providers. I haven't heard you mention corporations and companies, because corporations pay for expats to go on, and I know, having been an expat, that they pay an absolute fortune to try and induct you, and they do spend a lot of money. So why wouldn't you tap into that?
We haven't done that yet. I mean, there are a whole range of newer revenue generation possibilities which I can add on.
Okay.
I mean, there are possibilities, for example, to supply services to the companies which these expatriates work in, because more often than not, they have been moved in from the UK into Dubai, and they're the CEO of the company. So, they also have buying sort of influence. So there are a whole range of other things that we can do, and we will get to that. We could also deal with relocation agents, but some of these kind of revenue flows could be small, and the margins in that are also very small. And so we don't necessarily want to get into every single bit. We want to get into as many bits as we can where the revenue can be significant.
I'm so curious, because you aren't finding that there are informal groups of this sort already set up?
Yes, there are. What tends to happen is informal groups die as quickly as they are set up, because nobody has got the incentive to really keep them going. The moment whoever is the driving force leaves town, it just goes away, because everybody else wants to just benefit from a network rather than contribute to it and participate in it. So there are a number of small competitors that we have, which are of that kind, but they start and then they go away.
I'm just thinking about when I lived in America, there were lots of Welsh societies that had been there for
indeed.
A long, long time.
Yes, there are. I mean, there are various kinds of groups. I mean, I suppose we could think of the Rotary kind of groups, for example, or groups which are put together by the British Council or the British Embassy. But all of them have a different...
But competition is stifling?
No, actually, that competition is not felt at all.
Okay.
Because I think the problem with many of those kind of networks is they're too formal.
Back pocket?
Yeah,
they are could be impersonal and are not necessarily warm. So that's been our experience, and that's what creates the opportunity for us.
Can I ask you a little bit about kind of scaling this?
Yeah.
So there's the kind of the platform, the network element, but I guess kind of the revenue itself is coming from the events that you're putting on. Putting on events.
Yes.
labour-intensive. As you start to kind of multiply this out to more cities,
yes.
How do you go about actually kind of facilitating those events?
I have my community managers in of these five cities who manage events for me. They work for me part-time, but they do events every week. But only about, at the moment, about 70% of our revenue comes from the events, 30% comes from the services that we sell into.
Yeah.
And going forward, if we can get the membership fee coming through, then the upside is just, you know, unlimited. Because, you know, I'm looking to have, by 2020, almost a million members. I have a very, very big competitor already in this business who has the initial onboarding members. And they are in 390 cities. And they have 4,000 events a month.
Digitize that entire process.
But they also have a big problem because they are Teutonic origin. They are very formal. They are they are impersonal. What we do is we provide a warm embrace, and so we're different. We are informal friends. We want to be friends, and they want to be business contacts. So, you know, I think there's a very different culture. And ethos.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Of course, please.
Where does the investment money go if you secure investment?
I would spend it first and foremost on trying to sort of seed a few more cities.
Okay.
Because starting a community in each city costs about $10,000 and 6 months. And so every time, I've got 12 cities that I've seeded at the moment. And I've got five that are producing. Mm-hmm. I take the cash flow from that and seed the 12. And those are going to come on stream in the next, you know, every couple of months.
Okay.
Raj, well done.
Thank you.
Do you need a physical presence in those cities? Or
I do I have to at least visit it 4 or 5 times before it gets going. But my community managers are selected with a great deal of care. They are people who have self-interest in playing that role. They become social sort of divas or whatever. They become the most popular person around, and it also typically helps their day business. So, right.
We're going to have to close you out.
Thank you.
I'm going to close you out saying well done. I think there are a lot of lonely expats, and you're kind of serving them. My only thought for you to take away would be, is there any social good or CSR opportunity for the people that join?
We do that. We support the Poppy Ball, for example, every year in all the cities.
Right.
Thank you very much.
Super job. Well
Thank
done.
You very much.
Great
Thank
job.
You.
So, hi guys, my name is Ollie Bolton from What A Melon. As you may know, the natural hydration category has had explosive growth over the last few years. Predominantly, it's been led by coconut waters, which have had a huge success as a healthy alternative to soft drinks. However, there's a big issue with taste. We've sampled about 500 consumers, and more than 60% of them don't actually like the taste of coconut water and don't regularly buy it. Also, NPD with the natural hydration has been quite limited. It's been mainly led by the tree waters, maple and birch waters, which are quite expensive, lack nutrition, and there are also taste challenges with those too. So I'd like to introduce Watermelon, which is our new natural hydration drink. It's not from concentrate, has all the same electrolytes that you find in coconut water, plus it also has antioxidant lycopene and amino acid citrulline, which is really good for muscle recovery, so it's a really nice, strong sports proposition. But most importantly, the taste profile is much more palatable. There's a handful of watermelon drinks on the market, but Watermelon is unique in several ways. First of all, it's the only one in a Tetra Pak, so it sits really nicely next to Vita Coco on shelf and helps consumers understand it's part of a natural hydration category. It's got a 6-month shelf life, which are hopefully extending to 9 months compared to our competitors that have 30 days. It's got strong branding, it's got really good shelf standout, makes a slice when they're all on shelf. And we've got loads of fun marketing plans, which include our e-bikes, which we're using for central London samplings. Our team has successfully brought the Alibi health drinks brand to the UK. We've got 5,000 stockists at the moment, and we're in 4 supermarkets. My business partner, Tom, is ex-Coca-Cola. He was a commercial manager there. And my financial manager is ex-Lucozade Ribena Suntory. With your help, we believe we can make Watermelon Europe's number one watermelon water within the next 18 months. We've already got chili listings in Albert Heijn, which is a respected European supermarket in Holland. And in the UK, we're with Compass, with Whole Foods, and with Planet Organic. We've already achieved a really good rate of sale. And there's been loads of great positive press around watermelon water because Beyonce's invested in a US brand, which is a cold press, short shelf life watermelon water. The global natural adjacent category is now worth more than $1 billion, and the UK has grown at 73% year on year. It's dominated by coconut water, but due to the taste challenges, we feel there's a lot of untapped opportunity. With the right natural hydration product, we feel the natural hydration category could be much, much larger. If we were to win the prize, we'd use the funds to tell the world about watermelon, showcase this amazing fruit, and establish ourselves as a global player in the natural hydration category. So please back watermelon and back watermelon. I'd now like to share some samples with you and take any questions.
Thank you, Ollie.
Thank you.
Excellent. Okay. Love the bite. Love the shirt.
Thank you.
Pass those samples over and we will give you a taste test because you're quite damning of coconut water and tree water. But I accept that. That's all part of the game. My question is going to be around your geographic markets and and your current signed up stockists, because I heard you mentioned wholesale foods and 5,000 stockists. So say a bit more about your current geography spread and who's buying it today.
So our current, the current stock is for Alibi, which is another drink, which is our original drink, which I founded 8 years ago. So watermelon is our new product, which is 6 weeks, it's 6 to 7 weeks on the market.
Okay.
So that this pitch is just about watermelon.
Right.
And yeah, our stockists are in the UK, you know, Compass within their food service group, and then Planet Organic and Whole Foods, and then this supermarket in Holland called Albert Heijn. We're in 160 stores in their chiller, grab and go sort of sandwich fridge at the front of the store.
Take up in those channels since you launched 6 weeks
it's
ago?
It's been very positive. We're at about 50% of the sales of coconut water in Albert Heijn, and it's growing 30% month on month. So they've been very happy with it, and they've asked us to look into doing flavour extensions. So we've developed about 6 different flavour extensions. So similar to kind of Vita Coco, we look to have a kind of add a 10% fruit juice and have a different flavour range. And also, we've been in touch with two supermarkets in the UK who are interested in stocking it. Although what we're trying to do is launch with a chiller front of store grab and go. Deal with the supermarket.
Yeah.
And we've also been asked by one of the supermarkets to look into a 1 litre pack as well.
Is anybody doing watermelon water?
Yeah, there are. And in the UK, there's a brand called Mellow, but it's it needs to be chilled. It has a 30-day shelf life. You know, whilst I think it's a great product, there's great marketing you can have with the fruit. And it's still in kind of... It still hasn't maybe achieved the distribution, the mainstream distribution that we're looking to target. And part of that is by having the longer shelf life, and it's an ambient storage and logistics supply chain product.
Can we just look at the margins a little bit on, say, one of these? What's kind of the price point to a consumer? What are you selling it into the retailers at, and what's it actually costing you?
Yeah, so the retail price is about £1.99. We're selling to retailers at £1, and it costs us about 50p. To make, so we have 50% margin, which, you know, the average in the drinks is 35%, so it's quite a healthy margin.
Good for you, well done.
Thank you.
Yeah, nice easy numbers.
Thank you.
And it tastes good too.
Thank
you. So, Innocent Smoothies and the way they took their product, one of the tools they used was money back into charity.
Yeah.
And there's an element that's come up for me a little while as we've been looking at different things, and it's the fair trade model for coffee.
Yeah.
And it's very successful.
Yeah.
We've had different elements today. So I watched your video, and the watermelons you use are very different, 2.5 times bigger than the ones you buy in the store.
Yes.
If there was an element there somewhere down the line that they were going to be bought in a fair trade way or in a manner, that adds something a little bit extra, and I think the consumers might respond well to that.
So it's interesting you say that, and I haven't even mentioned this, but we're the first soft drinks company in Europe to be a B Corp. So we commit to a triple bottom line. So we're not just a profit making company. We also have social, environmental, and sustainability commitments. And we also, as a company, we partner with a charity called Drop for Drop. So we donate 5% of profits to water charity, Building Wells in India and Africa. But I think there's also a lot of interesting opportunities with specific fruit supply in Europe. And currently we source watermelons that have the lowest sugar content and the highest nutrient content. But I think that's a really good point, and we'd love to look in further to more into that.
Good.
Ollie, you're well done on the pitch.
Thank you.
Product tastes really good.
Thank you very much.
I'm glad you focused on sugar, because
I
know that there's certain regulatory issues that are, yep. are on the horizon, and I've talked to a few drinks people. What's the grammage in terms of product?
It's 6.3 grams per 100 ml.
Okay.
So typically about 40% less than apple orange juice.
How difficult would that be to get under 5?
Well, we
which
source,
may be, I'm just...
Yeah, I think it's possible. You know, it's all about sourcing the specific variant, and we've actually done tests on the product, and the actual sugar content is much lower than that, but we put on pack the highest potential sugar content, because it depends on the crop and the specific raw materials we use. But that's definitely a big target for us, is reducing the sugar further. And potentially, you know, we may look into adding other ingredients that can help us achieve that as well.
And my follow-on question is, in terms of the relationship between your previous business
yep.
and this business, who owns what? How does it work?
So it's a completely separate brand. It's the same team who are helping, so we're representing okay. the original product as well, although the focus is really on this new brand.
So you've done it once, that's successful, yep. let's do it again. This is the new
brand. The other brand, Alibi, kind of is running itself now, but we see this is where the real opportunity is, and we're focusing 80%, 90% of our time on watermelon.
So if we look at this product in particular, Ollie,
yeah.
so you've had some great early interest, kind of interest in further kind of product development on it.
Yeah.
Where do you think you can take this next kind of 2-3 years?
So we're looking for this year, specifically for watermelon, for £1 million turnover target. Year two, we're looking to hit 4, and year three, 12. Our EBITDA profit target next year is 15%. Moving to 17% is our ultimate goal.
Okay. And what's the ultimate aim? Trade sale?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, I love the drinks industry. I'm really passionate about creating health drinks yeah. that, you know, do people good. And so, I'd love to stay in the industry as long as possible.
And so one final question.
Yeah.
You know, do you feel confident about the 1 million year one number? Sounds like a
yes.
big number, but you feel confident?
Yeah, looking at our trajectory of sales, I think it's, you know, and sort of aware of it doesn't help anyone if you have the wrong forecasts for cash flow planning.
Yeah,
and so I think, yeah, I'm confident of that.
Ollie, I think we've run out of time.
Okay.
Thank you for the drink and the
thank
sample.
Thank you very much for your time.
Love the bike, love the pitch.
Thank
super
you.
Job, well done.
Cheers, guys. Thank you
well,
very much.
Wish you lots of success.
Good luck with the rest of the session.
Thank yeah. you. We're on a roll.
I'll try not to knock the camera on the way out. It could be a disaster, couldn't it?